another round of applause for me. Gets him every time. Very excited to be here. Took Amtrak down here today from New York City. Not the Acela though. It's a little rich for me. But I like their sales pitch. We'll get you to Philly 4 minutes faster for only $500 extra. It's a good deal. At least I didn't take Greyhound. That's always a little life victory for me. Greyhound is disgusting. I have had to take it to some gigs, but I try not to. Greyhound isn't even really a mode of transportation. It's more of a cry for help. You know, like I don't even call it Greyhound to people anymore. I just call it the anti-Olympics. Because every time you get on a Greyhound bus, it looks like every nationality is like their worst representatives. For the 12th year in a row, it's the Amish. That's right, Ezekiel, it does smell like shit on here. Because you and your brood of 17 are wearing 3 layers of homemade garments, and it's July. I was unaware that deodorant was part of Satan's plan to churn some butter flavored shit to stick under your arms. So my bus ride to Cleveland doesn't smell like a barnyard full of jock straps. I do fly to some gigs. I don't want you to think my career is all bullshit. It would be insane to fly from New York to Philadelphia. I think that would be a crazy person thing to do. I guess I took an hour trip to the airport. Went through security for 2 hours, took a 13-minute flight. Made my way to Helium. But I do fly to some gates, usually Southwest. You probably did the non-Acela Greyhound math on that one to figure out that Southwest would be my preferred airline. I just try not to take Spirit. I don't know if anybody here's ever taken Spirit Airlines, but they are not good. Yeah, they're terrible. I feel like when Spirit came into existence, everybody at Southwest just high-fived. Like, holy fuck, we look legit now! Spirit Airlines, they're a dishonest airline. That's one thing I don't like in my airline. It's dishonesty. Their airfares are the second most dishonest thing on the internet. Right after big girl selfies on dating websites. I think you know what I'm talking about. You know that pick, that angle pick, where it's like, get it up here, get my nice, pretty, well-fed, happy face in there. And then let me peck deck the tits. Get it up there, okay. Okay, I can't hold it much longer. Do you have the fucking angle? Take it! Yes! Got it. Let's go catfish the community. You gotta throw up a full body shot. You got to. Why would you want to show up to a date and have somebody be disappointed? Let them know what they're getting into. If I show up to a date, you know, like, I don't see her. Where is this friendly porn star that I'm supposed to be having drinks with tonight? So, wait a second. Fuck, that is you! What's all this about? You show up with extraneous woman to the date, we're going Dutch. That's my rule. We're still fucking, but we're going Dutch because I'm a man of principle. So anyway, back to Spirit Airlines airfares. It's true that if you just stay away from Spirit Airlines on the web, they're very tempting. You know, they'll get you in a world of hurt. You just do like, I'm going from D.C. to Los Angeles this week. Whoa. Spirit, D.C. to L.A., 49 cents. That's a good fare. Get on the plane, and then they're like, there's our $250 breathable air charge. It's optional, but we recommend it. It's now on the flight. Obviously, there's also our $100 landing fee, once again, optional, but recommended. The big thing that made Spirit famous or infamous was their baggage policy. Like a lot of airlines, they charge you if you check a bag. But they also charge you if you bring a bag on board. So I don't know who they're exactly trying to market to. Assassins on one-day missions. Sir, do you have any bags? Nope, not gonna get me on that bullshit, Spirit. I'm actually just going to Orlando for the day to murder the CEO of Spirit Airlines. I'll be back after dinner. And I did look that up. Because originally when I was gonna tell the joke, it was Omaha, Nebraska, because I thought that sounds funny. But you can't do that in comedy. Because in every club, in every state, there would be that one guy who'd come up to you after the show and go, funny story, but my cousin actually works for Spirit. They're based in Orlando, but still, funny joke. Sorry to be that guy, but I had to say something. It's like, first off, no, you didn't. And that's it. But that's just a preemptive fuck off to anybody here who choose to be that person after the show. So, what can I tell you? I feel like for the rest of my set, it's important that you know this so you're more comfortable with the jokes I make. But my father was black. True story. I know I don't even look Derek Jeter black, but my father was black, but my mom is 100% Irish, so that's like the racist Clorox bleach of ethnicities. So you get this, there's some sort of hate crime in the womb, and because I know you rarely see, you really almost never see the white side win in that matchup. It's like the Harlem Globetrotters and the Generals. Like, it's usually the black team that wins. But basically, it's just me and Rashida Jones holding it down on this end of the spectrum, and everybody else is Obama or darker. Comes the breaks. But I am writing a book which you can get next year. It's called What White People Say Around You When They Think You're a Giant Italian Guy. And the answer is a lot. But yeah, people always ask, oh, is your dad light skinned? He must have been light skinned. I'm like, yeah, not really. Kind of medium tone. A Morgan Freeman black with a dusty milk chocolate. Not an Amistad black, but narrate movies black. But he was Haitian. Mom's Irish, she was Haitian, so that still gets a weird response from people even in 27. Like, Haitian and Irish, wow. That is weird. How'd they meet? Work. That's it. My mom does not work for the Miami Coast Guard, so it's not a cool story. Why did the way, Philadelphia? Okay. At that rate, I have like two more jokes left. If I have to wait, if I catch up, it's like, that's my time. I don't have time for two jokes. I laughed in a very odd, like dominoes falling. And it's eventually the last person got it 19 minutes into my set. But yeah, Haitian Irish, I tell people a different story, and I'm like, it is weird how they met. I'm glad you asked. Mom, working class Irish girl from New York City. Dad, one of 10 kids, growing up in a small village in Haiti. And then my mom started sponsoring my dad for 46 cents a month. Postcards and learn how the school was coming along and helping build. But obviously intimacy was a problem at first. Helping the flies buzzing around my dad. But love conquered all, here I am. Father passed away in February. Don't worry, he was 85, that's a good run. Okay, that wasn't the joke. I gave you 10 seconds of sincerity in my entire sentence. Oh God, that was a good one. He thought 85 was a good run. No, but 85 isn't good, or maybe it was the cultural difference. The 85 is like 206 in white years, so. The father was actually 3 Black Lives Matter, and that's how old he was. Conversion rate if you're looking for it. But when he passed away, I sometimes a sad thing can happen when you learn something good out of it. And when he passed away, I got a condolence email from an ex-girlfriend, which was very nice until the last line where she informed me that she had gotten fake tits. It's a true story, and there's no way I would bring that up if it wasn't true. Like, that sounds so dumb to make up, like, I was throwing a thing about my dad's funeral and my ex getting fake tits. It happened. I got an email, and maybe I'm old-fashioned. Maybe that's it. But I just feel like that's got to be a separate email. Right? It was just so surreal. It was like, all right, you couldn't just wait a day on that one. So, different Hallmark card. That was an email, it wasn't a Hallmark card. But you learn. You learn that, hey, maybe it's a good thing we're not together. Because I feel like, maybe that's one of my deal breakers. Must know the difference between condolence email and surgical enhancement email update. But I hope her new tits are working out well. So weird. We live in a weird society, people. I got a dog, though. That's the circle of life, like they said in The Lion King. You lose a parent, you get a dog. I had a dog before my father passed away. It's not even historically accurate what I just told you. But I did. I adopted a dog because I wanted to struggle for the next 10 to 12 years. Because that's the thing. Everybody, they insist with your life, these pet people. Who clapped here? Who clapped? Was it?
It wasn't.
No, you hate dogs. I see you have a little evil hot look to you. You love dogs. Yeah, it's people like this that get, you've got to adopt. They don't care what your life is, what you're going through. You must adopt! And I'm like, wait, but this pet store dog looks pretty friendly and not too fucked up. Can I get that? Because really all I'm looking for is something to pet, feed, play with, take to the park, keep me company. Right? I'm not looking for, like, a special needs goth teenager on 4 legs and fuck up my world. My dog was abandoned in a trailer park, so she's got a hardy immune system, so she's gonna be here for a while. And I'm a giant. This dog might outlive me. I don't know. But you gotta get. It's like they don't ask what's your life like? Maybe you just should get a regular dog. No, you gotta adopt. You gotta get a fucked up piece of shit, just a piece of crap dog. I'm like, when do I get to enjoy my dog? Like, when do I get to? Because right now it's a very one-way relationship. But she's okay overall. Dog's okay. She's half golden retriever, which is pretty good. on the secondary market. I didn't think I'd get the golden retriever, well, half golden retriever. I didn't think golden retrievers could be homeless. That was the thing. Like, I thought they were like the big tit blondes of the dog world. I've never seen one of those homeless right on the street, like, wait, the fuck are you, what are you doing out here? You know, there are a lot of people who will take care of you. There are homes and gentlemen that will provide for you, for sure. You shouldn't be out. What's that? No skills and a bad attitude? Doesn't fucking matter. It doesn't matter. For some reason, we value what you bring to the table, so. Yeah, get off these streets, lady. But yeah, my dog, half golden retriever, half something else. I don't know what it is, but I tried not to bring it up. I don't think it was consensual. But she's good. She's a good, good dog. But yeah, are you like one of the anti-pet store kind of people? Yeah, rescue. What burning building did you run into?
I adopted! I didn't rescue shit! I sent money and emails. By that measure, I rescued some sneakers last week. Come on! These fucking New Balance wide fit sneakers aren't gonna beat themselves. You gotta get in there and get them. But then the thing they always say, you can't go to a pet store because they get their dogs from a puppy mill. I'm like, oh, I don't know what that means. That sounds fine to me. I know it's not. But it's not, like, if you don't know, you're just like, the puppy mill sounds like a place I would bring my nephews on the weekends, right? Like, where are we going, Uncle JL? The puppy mill? What's that? That's where they make puppies. Whoa! Right, rename it something else. Rebrand it if you really wanted to scare the shit out of people. Like, you can't get the dog from the pet store. Why not? They get their dogs from Mike Vick's Dog Rape Emporium. That sounds horrible. But what should we do with the pets that are in the pet stores now? Do you have a solution? Just burn it. Just burn the pets. Everybody after this show, just go to your local pet store and burn it down. Somebody, you know, somebody's got a pet. All right, that was dark, I agree. Because there's innocent lizards and fish in that pet store. What the fuck was that? My dog, right? I don't even have a dog. What the fuck am I talking about?
I knew that would be weird if I just spent like 10 minutes building this elaborate, weird universe of shitting on adopted pets. And they're like, he doesn't even have a dog. What the fuck? Is this guy insane? Is he even a comic? What am I doing here? Yeah, but my dog, she's okay. She looks like a kind of miniature, like, blonde Labrador. She's a pretty cute dog. But they found her abandoned in a trailer park in Kentucky. So pretty sad. So I'm pretty sure my dog is DTF. I see the way the other dogs look at her in the dog park. A blonde abandoned in a trailer park in Kentucky. It's the biography of a whore if I ever heard one. My dog was 1 week away from doing porn and MMA. That's how fucked up her life was before I stepped in. And now I got her in Bible study. It's going well. Dog is expensive, though. Not getting the dog. I got her bargain basement rate. But the upkeep on this animal is unbelievable. It cost me $300 to get this dog. $300. That was it. Every trip to the vet since I got her has been more expensive than the $300. That's not a good deal. It's like if you bought a car for $20,000 and every time you have to take it into the mechanic, it was like, that'll be $25,000. Like, oh, I should just take the fucking bus. But yeah, with the vet being so expensive, I guess the whole point of this is I'm raising my dog as a Christian scientist. Yeah, I'd like to get rid of those tumors, obviously. But that's actually against her beliefs. So. And the power of prayer to her, obviously. Anybody see Thor Ragnarok yet?
No.
You're pretty fucking fired up, right? How old are you, 14? When did we let, no offense, I'm probably gonna see it too. But that's because I'm bored and I got nothing to do in this city. I'm kidding, Philadelphia Pride, settle down. What do you mean you could go to an Eagles game and shout slurs at people? There's plenty to do. Okay, so we found where the Philadelphia people are touchy. That's one of my favorite things about this club is that you got that like New York DC smarts running through your veins, but you're also horrible people. That's why I like performing here, because like they get the jokes and they have no souls. It's the perfect comedy audience, but all of a sudden I make reference to your beloved Eagles and you're like, not here, sir. Stick to making fun of fat chicks and immigrants. Not Carson Wentz. My favorite movie about Philadelphia, I think, is probably Philadelphia. It's a good movie. It's a good movie. But I think the thing I like about Philadelphia is not just that it's a good movie in its own right, but that it is actually a sequel to Forrest Gump. You're going to realize that Tom Hanks was doing that because Forrest Gump came out later, like a prequel. This Philadelphia was 93, then Forrest Gump comes out in 94, and people are like, they didn't make the connection that it was a prequel. Because let's say, you know, Forrest Gump, obviously, he's a moron just running around America, just doing fun stuff, and then he finally fucks Jenny and gets that mysterious 80s flu that was going around. She dies, but she leaves him with a little kid, Haley Joel Osment. So he says, holy fuck, I know I'm stupid, but I got a kid. I better get my shit together. So he goes to law school, becomes a successful litigator in Philadelphia. Fucks Antonio Banderas, he's too dumb to know that he's giving him the flu too. Too much. And he croaks. It's sad. But then 5 years later, his kid grows up to see dead people, so they probably can see each other again. Pretty good. My dream is one day for those three movies to be packaged as like a Blu-ray trilogy. As if they're connected, like you didn't see Retarded AIDS Part 1. What about Dead Kid of Dead AIDS Dude? Sixth Sense. You guys let me explain, because I did that bit much more straightforward on the early show and they loved it, so I sent these lake people, they'll let me fuck around with them like I'm a jazz musician finding the notes, and you really didn't. You gave up on me very quickly. But back to the superhero fans. I mean, they're good movies, most of them. I just feel like we could cap it at like 15 a year at this point. I think that's enough comic book movies per year. I don't think I'm being too insane saying that. Because too many adults are getting like very invested in comic book movies. Like, I'd love to see that passion about things like elections or the environment. But sure, who the fuck is playing Batman is pretty important too. Because that was the thing, a few years ago, that's when I saw it get out of control and step back from the comic book world, which was when Ben Affleck, was I making that into one word? When Ben Affleck was cast as Batman, I had a lot of people on my timeline on Facebook going, what the fuck are they doing? Are you fucking kidding me? Ben Affleck? Fuck no. And I was like, well, he's white, he's rich, he's pretty jacked, he's pretty good looking. Like, that seems to be like 99% of Bruce Wayne right there. He hasn't even read any dialogue yet. I think they nailed it. People get too upset over this shit. People want diversity in their superheroes, and that's the one thing where I'm like, I become like a Fox News commentator. I'm a left guy, but when it comes to superhero movies, I'm like, no, white people can keep it. It's okay. Who gives a shit? In real life, black people are superheroes. That's the thing. What do you think Usain Bolt is? LeBron James, Lexington Steel? These are extraordinary people.
So what if Peter Parker is a whiny white bitch from Queens? I don't need Donald Glover to play him, it's okay. I think porn stars are like superheroes. That would be cool if Marvel just made a series of films based on porn stars, like they were superheroes. Right, you see that. That'd be cool. Big Boobs 2, she's fucking awesome. Huge Dick 3, like you'd be like, yeah, these people are amazing. But you'd never want to see the first one in the series, that's the problem. Because in regular superhero movies, the origin story is the coolest thing. Not in porn superheroes, though. It's kind of sad. Yeah! Big Tits won! The critics didn't really dig it because there wasn't a lot of action. There was really just a lot of basement stuff with her uncle. It was pretty fucking gross, to be honest. But Big Tits 2 is awesome. Tons of action! But I'm not sure I really want to watch The Origin again. Pretty creepy. Alright, Philadelphia. There's only one true Philadelphia comedy fan, and it's some sick human being right over here who laughed his ass off appropriately at that. Everybody else was like, I don't. They're actually empowered sex workers, and I think you should honor and respect their contributions to society, so I don't know why you're making a crude joke about how they got it, because it's usually not that fun. Did you think they were touched by the hand of God? They were touched, but not by the Lord. I thought the Late Show, what kind of late show are you? You got a bachelorette or old ladies party? I don't know where the fuck you're doing. Thank you, but at the same time, it's like, what are having a bachelorette party showing up and just ruining everything? God dang, that should have been a hint. And everybody else here is like, you got one hero willing to laugh his ass off about some porn star getting diddled in a basement. And everybody else is here, we're the new Philadelphia. We don't throw snowballs at Santa. We hand out canned goods before Eagles games. Human beings? Where are they? Are they on tour or something? Is that what they're around here today? I feel like this club got gentrified or something, but it was always white people, but now it's like upper crust white people. Grimy white people. Selling CDs after the show. I wish that was a joke, but it's not. It's a serious statement. I'm an excellent comedian, and there are excellent albums. Two of the albums both hit number one on iTunes when they were released, so they're good. And then the third album is an album of me entirely as Donald Trump. Now, you haven't heard me do Donald Trump yet, but you will, and then you're going to come running to get the album. But they're 10 each, or all 3 for $20. I suggest you get all 3 for $20 because the money goes to charity. So even if you didn't enjoy me, I'm basically talking to everybody except that dude. The money doesn't go to me, it goes to charity. I am sponsoring the impoverished son of a Haitian man. Pay attention to those people we all hope they forget. And this is in some bullshit Y-Clef charity for red tape and administrative costs, and everybody's getting their 100% of the proceeds go right to that kid. So open up those hearts that apparently you now have Philadelphia. I have never been so disappointed to see a city improve itself. So. But I'll leave you with this. I didn't vote for Donald Trump, but I understood why a lot of people did, because I feel like I can understand people being tired of politics as usual and all the bullshit,
you know, so I understood looking for an alternative, for a new choice. Similar to the way when Tiger Woods was married to a beautiful model and said, I need something new too. So the fucking ugly Denny's waitress in a parking lot in my car at 2 a.m. Because sometimes you need something new, something fresh, some new perspective. And that's what our president is. He's a fucking dumpy waitress at Denny's doing math in an alley with Tiger Woods. But I respect, if you voted for him, I respect that too. Can we stop the news? And I'm not one of these guys like the media. The fucking stop complaining. The media is fine, but except for Fox News, they're a propaganda organization. But if you like that, if you like Fox News, I respect that. I respect them. But they're shoving horse shit down your throat. You're gulping it down. No, but because every media outlet keeps saying, you know, Donald Trump doesn't like to let people know he's thinking. He likes to surprise people. He likes to take things as they come, and it's like, no, he doesn't know what the fuck he's doing. Stop pretending like that's strategy. That's not, like, he doesn't know anything. And he's a terrible, but on the good side, he's a terrible person. So, but other than that, I think he's doing a good job. But I will say this, I went to Georgetown Law School, so before I became the legend that you see now, I was an attorney. Like, my life is pretty much a Drake song in reverse. But I do, I still have friends in politics, in government, and Trump next month is actually unveiling a new jobs program. So I thought I'd share it with you tonight. Believe me, people of Philadelphia, you're very good, you're very good people. These are tremendous. I mean, to be honest, I'd prefer it if you weren't so close to, you know, the Joel Embiid type Philadelphia people. You know what I mean? I prefer kind of the Pittsburgh, the central people. But anyway, you're good people. This looks like my kind of crowd. And I want to talk to you about jobs because we have to do something to bring back the jobs to America. Okay, under President Obama, what a failure. We lost so many jobs. It was unbelievable. Even some of our, and the hardest hit, by the way, were the African Americans, okay? The blacks were really hit hard under Obama. Because a lot of people don't know this, but I know it. The NBA, okay? The NBA, basketball people, used to be one of our great employers of black people. And then under Barack Obama, under his administration, a lot of those jobs went to white Europeans. I don't even know white Europeans could play basketball. I do, but a lot of you might not know. So the first step under my administration is we're going to make the NBA stand for nothing but African Americans. Believe me. But the main part of my job's plan, and it's a beautiful, big, beautiful plan. Under Barack Obama, all these blacks that lost jobs. It was really sad. And we have a crumbling infrastructure. And believe me, I built a lot of beautiful buildings, okay, so I know about building. We've got to rebuild our infrastructure, so here's what I have for you. We're going to give all the unemployed African-Americans, I gotta say African-Americans because I gotta be PC, the media, they're gonna say I'm saying the wrong thing. We're gonna take these unemployed African-Americans and give them unpaid internships to rebuild our beautiful infrastructure. We'll get to do it on the cheap, which saves the American taxpayer money, and I love that. And they are going to get valuable skills that they can take to their next job. And believe me, they should honestly be thankful for it. And here's the best part, people. The name of the program. Not slavery. It's not slavery. Now, the lying media, I can see them already. They're going to say, Donald Trump is bringing back slavery. How can I be? How stupid is that? How can I be bringing back slavery when the name of the program is not slavery? It's not slavery.